Hello and welcome to The Vote with me, Frank LeDuc, and my guest today, Geoffrey Bowden. I was about to say Councillor Geoffrey Bowden, sorry. Revisit past sins on you.
Not been that for a long time.
Thank you for joining us, Geoffrey, and Happy New Year. Welcome to the programme and all that. I wanted to look ahead to the 2017 in Brighton and Hove, sort of politically, if you like, and you've been there and done that. Got the hat, got the T-shirt, got the scars. And the first thing that strikes me that's going to be happening over the next 2 months is the council's going to set its budget. They're looking at about a 5% rise. How does that sit with you?
Well, I suspect the last administration would have loved to have a 5% rise rather than 2%. And we were opposed by both the current administration, the Labour Party, and the Conservatives. And I suspect secretly, the Labour administration is ruining the day that they opposed a slightly higher rise, because they would be starting the whole process at a higher tax base from where they are now. Since our time, the cuts that have been imposed on local government from central government have not diminished in any way.
So it's still pretty tough and getting
tougher. It's very tough, and I have every sympathy for those people having to make the hard decisions. So when you're having to toss up between whether you keep something like social services, which is, you need to deliver, or youth services, you're going to have to make some very, very tough choices. And you're not going to please all the people all the time.
Certainly not.
And that's a situation I think Labour finds itself in administration. And they're probably going to feel even more uncomfortable by having to rely probably on Tory support to get their budget proposals through, because we know that my old colleagues will be opposed to cuts wherever possible, and that was their manifesto pledge, that they would resist cuts to every extent. And people may say that's gesture politics.
And some have.
And some have. And I accept that completely. But unless you make a noise, and I know there are noises off, and it's not just from Green councillors. Noises off are coming strongly from Conservative-controlled councils, who are telling their colleagues up in Whitehall that things have gone too far, especially with social services.
I mean, I guess the real challenge. This is always the sort of one of the stories, if you like, this time of the year, the budget, how much the council tax will go up by, and because it is restricted by the government. You don't have complete freedom as a council to do what you want. So the other side of the coin is, where do you save the short, the money for to fund the shortfall, or where do you make the cuts? I guess one of the things the public doesn't see is that a lot of these savings, or some of these savings, will be made behind the scenes, merging council departments, reducing the number of buildings that are in use, for example, and the sale of King's House is a case in point.
Yeah, I mean, the Green administration set that in train. But it'll be a one-off payment.
Yeah.
So if we get £8 million for a pile of bricks, that's fine.
But the cost of running King's House year in, year out has gone, hasn't it? Now, once it's sold.
Once it's sold, we've got the asset realised.
Yeah.
That's a one-off slug of money.
Yeah.
To plug a gap, but currently I think the budget, there's about £1 million. Gap between the proposals and what they need to achieve.
Still, after a lot of hard work to get to this point.
So there's going to be a lot of anxiety. It may be a lot of... last time I went to the King's House, it was like going into the Marie Celeste.
Yes.
There were sort of empty cups of coffee on desks and no one about, and people have gone. Yeah. And I think there's a concern that we are losing some very talented people. I've been to a series of farewell dues for very, very good officers who are leaving the ship, and having
by
that...
By choice, or because this is part of the reorganisation that's been taking place?
Some by choice, others by not. I mean, I went to one just before Christmas, someone who was pretty high up, who went by choice, and she felt that the direction of the council wasn't to her taste. And she's gone off, and she's remaining in public sector, but a lot of good talent is no longer there,
yeah.
And that's a concern.
It's. I mean, again, I suppose the. You know, I saw some comments left under a story recently on one of the local news sites, and it almost said, "Yeah, why should the council be doing this?" But I guess the council is kind of like the sort of the place where everything, you know, everything that sort of we expect to be done on the pub for the public benefit, and if nobody else is doing it, it sort of defaults to the council.
Well, it's a difficult choice. I mean, the council delivers around 700 services overall, and people may not be aware of them because that's not necessarily in their sphere. If I talk, for an example, of something that I'm close to, I'm a member of my local park volunteer group committee, yeah. Friends of Queen's Park. We expect most parks to be maintained and looked after by volunteers kind of going forward.
Yeah.
So last year there was a tussle about how many park rangers we could afford. But they are still council property, and there will be some stuff that we can't do, even with the best will in the world.
Yes.
And having people pitch up, if they're available, to do some of the basic maintenance. I was, you know, painting toilet blocks last year and cleaning playgrounds along with a lot of other volunteers. That, I mean, is that going to be sustainable? So what a lot of the those kind of friends groups and, you know, I know you've spoken to Alan Robbins recently.
Yes.
You know, he has, for the moment, libraries in his portfolio.
Yes.
I think that's going to transfer to Councillor Emma Daniels shortly. You know, maybe the friends groups of parks will be transferred into the friends groups of Hove Library, the Jubilee Library, and you'll see more volunteer groups coming to the fore, because that's the only way we're going to do
it. A direction that some other councils around the country have taken already with this, where they've tried to keep libraries open.
But of course, we can't guarantee there will be person power and expertise power, and all those people still need to be managed.
Yes.
So if we have to start plodding trees or cutting down elms in Queen's Park, that's not something we
necessarily the council, do as friends.
Yes, I don't think the council can expect that.
I mean, in terms of also what's coming up this year, I mean, there's, you know, if the council wants to put the council tax up beyond a certain point, and I don't think Labour do, they'd have to hold a referendum, which is something that in the last year of the Green administration was looked at, but that was defeated.
Well, it was defeated by the combined forces of both the Labour and the Conservative group. And, you know, I can understand the arguments, because there are a lot of hard-pressed families and individuals out there that a couple of percent on council tax makes a huge difference to their lives, and you want to try and avoid that. But the government is holding out what I call a sticking plaster in terms of social services, but a 2% rise to cover social services ain't going to do it.
It's not going to cover the shortfall.
And they need to listen to their Conservative colleagues who are speaking through the local government association, the LGA, who are saying precisely that.
A battle we can expect to see played out this year, I suspect. I mean, before we sort of, before we take a break in a few moments, I guess one last question on the referendum thing, by the way. I guess if we had had one, it might have either put to bed the idea that people will pallet a big council tax rise, or actually they'd have said yes, in which case the council would have more funding. I know the council tax probably doesn't raise as much as people imagine, but it's but it helps.
And a lot of it is hypothecated. So a big chunk of the of our income is hypothecated to the education sector.
Yeah. So and you basically, it comes in, but it goes straight out.
It comes in, it's a kind of a...
The council effectively acts like a bank.
Yes.
It gets the money from the government, and it makes sure it's distributed properly.
So we're left with a very small residual value of the income we get. And I know we're going to be shortly able to keep 100% of our
business rates,
but that's not yet.
Yes.
And you know,
and there's a change with revaluation as well. There have been changes so that more small businesses are exempt. So just at the same time as they're saying you can have this money, the actual amount you're going to get is being
we're being pushed one way and pulled the other way as ever. So it's in the old history lessons we call Morton's fork.
Morton's fork,
where you were prodded one way and pushed the other way. You didn't. It was a no-win situation.
This is why one of the reasons why I've always sort of felt, I think, a lot happier sitting at the back of the room at council meetings reporting on them than sitting in the hot seats, trying to make the very, you know, the decisions that you stand and fall by. I mean, I guess in terms of, you know, social care, is this the year you think the social care battle might actually finally play out? Because we've had sort of royal commissions or sort of great big sort of independent reports about this, and yet we're still wrestling with the same problem for 20, 30 years
well,
now.
Well, people have been saying the same thing for years, and it's become more acute now, and the government has kind of recognised this with this small concession, but it is a tiny concession, and it will not actually fill the gap. We've got an ageing population,
yeah.
And I know we're going to talk about health issues yeah. later on.
I was going to say, this really rolls into health quite neatly, actually.
Yeah.
I did want to ask you about that.
But let's talk about that maybe in the second half.
Well, yeah, no, absolutely. I think we're going to take a break in about 30 seconds. But just before we do, what's your sort of health role? How do you have an interest in that?
Well, I'm a director of something called Health Watch, which is a kind of a voice for patients and users of yeah. health and social care.
Yes. So you're sort of like an independent local watchdog.
Absolutely.
Brilliant. Well, listen, don't go away. Please join us after the break. We're going to go and take a short break for these ads. So, again, please just join us in a few minutes. Hello and welcome back to The Vote with me, Frank LaDuke, and my guest today, Geoffrey Bowden, a member of director of the local Health Watch, as we were saying just before the break. Yeah. Geoffrey, welcome back. The year ahead in health, well, can I just get the ball rolling with one change that's going to happen that we know about? Brighton and Sussex University Hospitals, the local NHS Trust, runs the Royal Sussex, the Eye Hospital, etc. They've been in special measures. They've got a new board effectively taking over in the coming months. How's that going to work? Because these people are not going to leave their previous jobs, are they?
Well, at the moment, we've got a new chief exec coming in from a neighbouring trust. So people are nervous about whether this is going to be a long-term takeover.
Yes.
And therefore, we would be worried about where is the local input, where is the local connection with residents and patients and users of the trust locally.
Yeah.
But also there's a big financial pressure. There's about a 50 million quid.
Can I say 60 million?
Oh, would it? Maybe.
60 million deficit by the year end.
60 million by the year end.
That's the current forecast.
So there is a lot of work to be done.
Yeah.
We know that those people at the sharp end delivering are working their socks off.
Yeah.
And I've had occasion to use the local trust for personal reasons recently, and I can only praise the people. They're working under very, very difficult circumstances.
The Care Quality Commission, the CQC inspectors, and one of the things I always sort of come back to with their report is it does praise the sort of the frontline, you know, medical staff, the clinicians, the doctors and nurses, for the care they give pretty much most departments most of the time.
Yeah.
You know, it's the problems that put the trust into special measures seem to be the sort of, if you like, the management and leadership structure and the way it's worked and the finances and I'm guessing as well the finances are not entirely within the trust's gift.
Well, some of it is and some of it's not.
Yes.
But also they're into the whole conundrum and jigsaw puzzle of how health and social care is delivered is the commissioning.
Yeah.
And we've got an absolute perfect example of how it doesn't work. We have a transport service for patients,
co-performer scandal,
which
yes.
was a virtual car crash
yeah.
in an exemplar of how not to do it.
Yeah.
And it was masterminded remotely from a neighbouring authority.
Yeah.
And essentially what we got was a call centre with some subcontractors who didn't get paid.
Yeah.
And, you know,
two of which went out of business, I think.
Yes, and, you know, had to yeah. ask the question, have we got fit-for-purpose yeah. commissioners who actually know what they're doing?
Yeah.
And not actually creating the public purse even more money, because this whole, that as an example of how money can get wasted,
yes.
it's the public purse that which will have to pick up the pieces
yeah.
and pay off those companies who are still in business, who are owed money,
yeah.
and all that money would buy hip operations and cataract operations yeah. and all the other things.
Pay for nurses and
doctors. And pay for nurses yeah. and doctors.
Yes. I mean, one of the things, there are two things that might come together this year a little bit, I guess. I mean, Jeremy Hunt recently said, you know, we're going to train more homegrown doctors. And
do you know how long it takes to train a doctor?
Unfortunately, yes. I mean, it's not just a three-year degree.
It takes 6 to 8 years to train a doctor.
Yeah. I mean, if you've got 5 years of university study, for starters.
And then we've got 56% of our NHS workforce who are not UK nationals.
Yeah.
And for a lot of them, there is a huge question mark over whether they will be able to remain working in the country once Article 50 is triggered by the government.
Well, what Brexit will mean, as it were. I mean, I guess this is one of the things we've got, not just in the hospital in Brighton, but we've got across the piece in tourism as well, in places like Amex. We've got a huge number of people who've come here from other countries, many of them European Union countries, to work, and they've got free movement at the moment. But once we've left the European Union, the question mark remains about whether they can stay, if so, for how long, whether it's open-ended or they've got, you know, got to stay for just a set period before they've got to leave, as it were.
Well, I suspect, we're segueing into Brexit,
but
as it impacts on those sectors, health and tourism, there's a vital impact on the local economy.
Yes.
We're dependent that the tourism sector, at the height of the season, employs around 17,000 people.
It's seasonal workers, extra
seasonal workers,
jobs.
But also, you go into our hotels,
there
are people who are working there who have a particular skill set, particularly in languages, that are vital for the operation of our hotel sector.
Yeah.
And that represents a huge sector, a segment of our local economy. And in health, that we've just mentioned, overall, we're about more than 56% of... there are 56,000 workers, nurses, doctors and other professionals working in the health sector whose future security of tenure in posts is in doubt while these negotiations go on for however long it is, 2 to 10 years.
Yes, so no one could be surprised if they were thinking, well, I might just actually look elsewhere just in case and get ahead of the game, as it were.
I know of a Spanish national nurse who is doing exactly that.
Yeah, and I'm sure that's replicated many times. And we at the Royal Sussex, we recruit very heavily from Spain and Portugal, from the Philippines, which is outside the European Union, obviously, and from Ireland as well. So, again, the sort of key sources of recruitment.
Quite what the Irish status is, I don't know.
Well, again, that's going to be an interesting one, isn't it?
That's something I'm sure Boris and Theresa and the other chap, David...
David Davis, have got a grip on if they
know absolutely what they're doing.
Only share it with us. Yes. Can I just row back to health 1 second, which is the other thing that was... the Health and Wellbeing Board, which is sort of part of the council, and I suppose normally oversees our local commission, health commissioners... They faced a few brickbats over the past year or so with the closure of 6 doctor surgeries in Brighton Haven in the past 2 years. And there was a warning given last year by that the new pharmacy settlement that affects our chemist shops means that actually we shouldn't be surprised now if we start to see pharmacies close as well.
I've got an absolute example from my own experience.
Already?
My surgery closed last year or the year before.
Last year.
Eaton Place.
Yeah.
Result, the boot surgery in Kemp Town is up a rock garden, not up rock gardens, well, it's around the corner from where I live. It will be closing next week.
Oh, wow, okay.
So there is an impact on the surgeries closing, on the number of pharmacies that are going to be available.
Right.
That will have an impact on people who may not be close to a pharmacy.
Yes.
May not be close to transport links to get to a pharmacy. I have to go and get a repeat prescription now for me and what happened to me earlier this year, or last year.
Last year.
and I now have to decide where I'm going to go and get it. Now, I'm okay because I've got a bus service and I've got a motor, but others won't be in such a great position.
It's interesting as well, looking at the... it's funny how they work these things out about whether we've got enough chemist shop for an area, because there are little clusters. You'd expect that in places like Western Road and sort of the town centres, as it were, Brighton and Hove. But when you get out onto the estates, some have got 2 or 3 pharmacies, some have got none at all, and all buses lead to Churchill Square, as it were, rather than necessarily.
If you've got a bus stop near you, if you've got a mobility issue, then it becomes a very critical personal. Battle in order to be able to access pharmacy or GP services, and this is something that Health Watch is definitely watching.
What on your agenda for this year, I guess? I just want to go back again, sorry to sort of crisscross a little bit.
I just want
to go back to Brexit and one of the other areas of our local economy that I guess where people have got questions and anxieties about what will happen as we work towards leaving the European Union are the universities and language schools.
Language schools in my day were worth about 300 million to the local economy.
it's no small beer.
So it's no small beer. And even down the end of where I live, there's an EF. Yep. EF, I've forgotten what the EFC or something like that.
EF International, is it?
EF International,
that's the one. I can't remember, but yes.
And they have a school, EF. And if you can see the knock-on effects, isn't they not only are they coming in and going to doing the courses, they are being housed, often hosted by local families.
So it's extra money.
It's all money into the local economy. There's usually a social program because they're young people. And whether they will be able to get into the country easily to study English is a moot point and needs to be considered.
If Brexit isn't handled properly, there's a risk we might be cutting off our nose to spite our face in sort of sectors like this.
And you know, the government often makes pronouncements about students overstaying their visas.
Yes.
Now these are very short-term courses, generally speaking, but it's a worry. Yeah, to say the least.
Whether actually they'll be able to come in the first place and spend the money that we benefit from in the local economy. Yeah. And Sussex University as well, which has a relatively high proportion of overseas students compared to...
Yes, and there's something called the Erasmus programme, which is a kind of inter-university across Europe programme where you get students come from this country being able to take courses in other universities in Europe.
Yeah.
There's a huge question mark about the future of that.
In terms of our involvement and our ability to benefit from it.
And whether our students will be able to benefit from
it. It's a good job. We're such good linguists in this country, isn't it? We can just go forth and...
Well, we are not good linguists. I have another hat on where we know that there is a de-emphasising of learning of languages.
We may have to ask you about that another time. Thank you so much for joining us. Have a good 2017 and please watch again soon.